Welcome, everybody. We are here on the SPOCAST season finale. What's up, Donnie B?
Man, that was awesome, dude. Who made that?
That was Corazon, the resident thief, the nabbit of
I love it. SPO. I love all the little stuff that, like that you guys do, all the little Easter egg stuff. It's just fantastic.
Yeah, he's awesome. So let's get Tommy in here. Tommy Grayson, what's up, brother? Tommy,
what up, bro? How you doing?
Good. Listen to that mic check. Nice and strong, brother. Love it.
Check 1-2. 1-2. How you doing?
Bada bing. Help me out with the chat, if you don't mind, brother, man.
I got
and
you.
Let's get your brother in here. JP, what's up, brother?
Here we are.
Nice.
How's it going, guys? How's it going?
Everyone's
what up,
good.
Brother, daddy, brother.
Good stuff. Man. So here we are, a very special edition. It is our Taking It Home edition. We are now, what, 6 days away from End Game, everybody. 6 days away. End Game Sunday is almost here. I can't believe it already. So this is our season finale. Next week will be our 21st episode, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly of WrestleMania Weekend. But that's next week. Right now, we have a lot to talk about. Tonight's a very special night. I'm kind of excited already, and I want to stop talking and let other people talk. So, Donnie, how was your week?
It was awesome, bro. Great song choice, by the way, for this. It was awesome. Great Easter. It's what it's all about. Family came together. We had a great time. Tons of people over. Big brunch. Egg hunt with the kids. They're getting a little older, so now they hide their own eggs. but it was awesome, man. It's, you know, you work hard, play hard. That's what I tell my kids every day. So we definitely played hard this weekend. We also saw Kane Brown in concert on Friday night, or Saturday night at the Newark Prudential Center. Went nice. To a great dinner. Had some friends over at Brando's. The great establishment in Asbury Park. They hooked us up with a reservation. We kicked ass there, had a great meal with friends of ours, and then we went to the concert, and it was a fantastic night, my man.
Great.
Stacked
wonderful.
Busy.
What about you, JP? How was your weekend, man? I mean, we're going to talk about the weekend and Loud East Wrestling, but in your life, how you doing, bro?
Doing good, man. Doing good. It was a nice, relaxing, low-key weekend. You know, aside from, again, that Loud East show, Easter was chill, laid back. Enjoyed my time with my family and, you know, got to hang out with my girlfriend. So great time and, you know, getting ready for Endgame and the rest of WrestleMania week and all the other festivities going on.
Yep, absolutely. And WrestlingCAWS, what's up, buddy? He said, nice, everyone's got their trench shirts on. That's right, guys.
Shout out to Explosion Apparel. These guys did an awesome job hooking it up. I waited for years to have an official Trent Acid t-shirt. And when I saw these, I knew that I had to jump on and snag a bunch for all four of us backseats. They hooked it up big, made sure that we got Big 80s, Donnie B, the Trent Acid t-shirt, made sure that all of the backseats got the Trent Acid t-shirt. And guys, I think these are so successful that Explosion Apparel is actually, you know, keeping the order online. So get them while they're hot, folks. Trent Acid t-shirts. These are going to a great cause. I believe all of the money is going to Alcoholics and Narcotics Anonymous recovery over in the UK. So, you know, we're not seeing a dime off of it, you know, full disclosure.
Right. Absolutely. Awesome. Never.
This shirt perfect is really timing, good. Though. It's really awesome quality, by the way. Like, it's thick. The printing's well done. I was going to say, who the hell made this? Yeah. But they did a hell of a job. This is a really nice shirt.
I love that random fans are in the crowd or on the shirt. Like, you just
that's my favorite picture of Trent, too, by the way. Who took that picture? Does anybody know?
I don't know, but I know it was in Delaware, so it had to be a CZW photographer.
Was it Lyle?
Could have been Lyle. Could have been Craig.
I'd like to know that. I really would. I never figured that one out or researched it.
Wrestling historians. Yes.
Yeah. Real quick. I don't want to break in real quick. I got to tell you, we have a very special night with the Messiah tonight, but we have to get something started here. I'm going to introduce my boy, Chris Dark King Sierra. Hey. What's up, Chris? Yes. How's it going?
How you doing, bro?
Chris. So,
what's up, bro?
We know you already did some good stuff recently as far as like who you've been sketching. So let me real quick, just show some of your work. You did Trent Acid recently.
Oh, this is the guy,
This is the guy. Just a few weeks ago, we did this. It was a Saturday night while these guys were in Canada, and we did it live. And then just last week, he went ahead and sketched Channing Decker, and you can check him out at IndieWrestlingArt_2. So
that
good job,
so
Chris.
Cool.
Thank you, fellas.
And Chris, you actually go to Gangrel's events down in Florida. That's where you live, right?
Yeah, Coastal Championship of Wrestling. They do that every second Friday of the month down at a place called Old Town Kissimmee.
Yeah, I saw your clips from it. It looks awesome. I want to get down to one of those shows
eventually. I did a show at Healy, Florida for them one time at the brewery. So, yeah, spot.
You tell Mr. Gangrel that Big 80's Donnie B says hello. And he wants him to come up here and watch My Blue Heaven again. He'll know what it means. Great story behind that. But he was one of my favorites to work with.
So, Chris, we're going to check in with you. I know you already did the sketch itself. We're going to be working on the coloring. So if you want to go ahead and show it off right now, brother, here's your moment.
All right. It's only a little peep. So let me see if I can get on the camera exactly. Now.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my gosh. It's the whole high five.
Yeah.
Wow.
High five.
Hold on. I gotta put up a picture. Check this out, Chris. That's us.
Yes.
That's the high five. Don't count us, by the way.
Oh man, that looks. Who's that ugly man in the front with the green jacket? That looks like a frog. Who is that?
That is Dewey Donovan.
Oh God, yeah, that's right. Brother,
turncoats have to turn on you to be a turncoat. So of course
he looked uglier then than he does now. How's that possible?
I don't think
that's he had hair. He had hair back then.
Well, so he doesn't have hair. He has strands. He doesn't have hair.
But yo, Chris, that is badass. What a surprise. I had no idea you were doing that.
Yeah, Wrestling Court saying sick high five.
Surprise.
Yep. Sick high five drawing Wrestling Court said from Australia. So there you go. You got your first compliment.
Now, if you could make that into like a thing that you could put on a shirt, that would be a cool shirt.
Yeah.
If he could make that drawing, like you could put it on a shirt or something, that'd be cool as shit.
Well, he sells them. He goes and sells them at the low. He sells his wares at the fair. This guy.
Oh, there you
Chris.
Go. I didn't know that.
So, exactly.
I wish I had a talent to draw, bro. I can't even draw a goddamn stick figure. I might be the worst artist who's ever lived, surpassed by my shitty basketball skills. I'm the worst basketball player in the history of the world, but I'm also the worst artist in the history of the world. So, Chris, you're awesome.
Thank you, but please, you're not Dennis Rodman going like that. Peace, baby.
Yo. If you guys saw the story today on Spo Wrestling or on my Instagram, Chris put up a little gimmick of SpongeBob dancing, saying, what is he saying? Walking on the beach or something?
He goes, stepping on the beach. Stepping on the beach.
Dude, Chris, I want you to understand that little 2-second skip video of Bob, it captured your personality somehow perfectly in 2 seconds.
I kind of got that from my dad.
What, you got your SpongeBobness from your dad?
No. He's kind of a joker, so I kind of got that from years
got
ago.
Got you. All right, so here's what I'm going to do, bro. I'm going to put you, if you want, can you show while you're doing it, like show it? Or do you want me to check back in with you every few, like so often? It's up to you.
Like
it's
this
probably
take,
easier, yeah.
This will take me check a little bit in. Of time, but...
Okay. All right, awesome.
That's crazy. So,
I know. Yeah. I can't wait.
I mean, those would be sick, you know, posters or 8x10s for the boys. If they, you know what I mean?
I want one just for my collection.
Bro, you know, that would be – no one's ever done a wrestling poster with the characters that look like that. You know how the guys make indie posters with everybody's picture on? That would be cool shit if he could do a poster like that for an event where everybody's hand-drawn like that.
That would be pretty
cool. Yeah, just something different.
I like that because some people use the cause, some people use the Grand Theft Auto thing nowadays.
The design.
But just that would be cool, man. If you were doing like some kind of themed show or something, I don't know, like Christmas or whatever, but that would be cool.
Yeah, put in the chat who you think Chris should draw next, by the way. Chris, I know you've drawn the Briscoes, you've drawn Nick Mondo, you've drawn Joey Janela, you've drawn so many guys.
Channing Decker.
So who do you think he should draw next? Put it in the chat. And Chris, good luck, brother. Get some drawing done. We're going to check in with you in a few more minutes, all right?
Hey.
My man.
Sunny Kiss would be a cool one. Sunny Kiss would be
awesome.
Cool.
That would be awesome.
I think she'd pop for that.
Yep. Yeah. And he has not drawn her yet either. Because
Or Homicide. I'd like to see Homicide's reaction to that.
That would
be
a good
cool
one
shit
too.
If he made one of him in Too Cold.
Yep. Absolutely. So I'm going to show real quick. We got a Pat Dynamite. We have a few words from him real quick going before his cinematic match. As you know, Pat Dynamite is going to be taking on Joe Clean in the first ever cinematic match here in SPO Wrestling. And that will be shown on the Tron this Sunday. You do not want to miss that. And here's what Pat has to say.
Hey, have you seen Joe Clean around here? I've been walking all up and down Burlington looking for this bitch-ass guy. You seen him anywhere? All right, well, if you see Joe, give him a message for me. Tell him that Pat Dynamite has been looking for his ass all up and down Burlington outside Mitchell Firehouse. And if he ain't here by April 7th, 3 p.m., I'm gonna have to do something drastic. Mr. Clean, I don't give a fuck about your blue jeans.
Whoa.
Because when I see you, they're gonna be piss yellow. Because I'm gonna beat the shit out of you.
Where did this come from?
I don't get it, dude. He's Rick Blade. Like in real life, he never curses, and then he gets on the mic and curses.
Well, he's wearing a rug. My favorite part is that he's wearing a Rugrat shirt.
I was just gonna say that.
And he's working blue, brother's working blue with a Rugrat shirt. This might be my favorite new indie guy.
Oh yeah, this. Dude. Definitely.
The drip. The
calling
drip
someone
unmatched.
Else a bitch ass. Oh, he's funny, dude. He is funny.
Wow. I can't wait to see that.
So before we get the Messiah on, we have some, the rep sent something in. And when I say the rep, I mean Dewey probably had his hand in this, of course. So
of course.
Let's hear what the rep has to say. I think this one, if I'm not mistaken, this has the F word in it too. So cover your ears if it offends your sensitivities, everyone.
Viewer discretion is advised.
Yeah.
All right. So we got to do this. All right. All right. Dewey, you making us do this. All right. We your boys. We got this. Okay. SPO. Okay, April the 7th, Burlington, New Jersey, blah, 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 blah. Okay, cool. Big cage match. Who we got? Okay, we got CXR, Silk City Kings, Golden Era.
But you know what? It really doesn't matter because there's only one tag team on that docket. It's the Backseats. Mm. The Backseats are the one that are holding the titles to begin with.
Mm.
Also, too, I don't really recall exactly how it happened. But they won the last time that we faced each other. And you know what? I have a problem with that to begin with.
Dog, you want
to
talk about a fluke is what you got. Because the last time we were in the ring, the last time we were in the ring together,
mm-hmm.
the Backseats were laying down, looking up at the lights, screaming in pain, while the rep and Dewey Donovan mm-hmm. were standing tall. So that's what we're going to do. April the 7th, forget everybody else. Everybody else in that match, everybody else in the cage. Do what you gotta do, but stay out of the rep's way. Back seats. We are gonna see you in the cage. And we're gonna handle this.
And of course, remind everybody.
Oh, that's right, that's right, that's right. You don't fuck with the rep.
Wow.
Man. This is becoming.
Put an NC-17 label on this program.
We got so many people coming after us for these, and man, if they want a shot, man, we'll see them in the cage. Regardless, those words don't hurt.
And it's free. It's free to the whole town. It's free to anybody. Come on down, 2:30 p.m. Sunday, April 7th. If you're hearing my voice, you still have time to be there, most likely. Make plans. And then after you watch two free steel cage matches outside. And by the way, it's going to be a really nice day that day. We actually are going to avoid the rain. So right here you see in Burlington, it's going to be 57 degrees and mostly sunny on the 7th. So after the two cage matches, everyone will move inside, and that's where tickets will be purchased if you don't already have them. There's very few general admission seats left. Ringside sold out almost immediately. So it's a small building. It's an intimate venue. And you really, with the Tron and the way everything is in there, every seat's a great seat. So buy your general admissions now so you don't get locked out. I would hate for you to come and watch the cage matches and not be able to get in, like with your kids or your family. You would just be a letdown, and we can't have that. So don't let your kids down. Buy your tickets in advance for SPO Wrestling this Sunday.
Like we said, part one is free, but rep, this ass whooping ain't going to be free. And, you know, that was a real cute promo you guys cut. Dewey, you know, just know that we're about to see a Cage of Death 5 repeat if your ass even thinks about coming close to the action. So, you know, be forewarned.
Mm-hmm. There's zero chance that Dewey involves himself in that. Zero.
I'd like to see even Dewey get into that cell. Even
Dewey gets hurt getting out of bed. He's not going to get involved. I'm surprised
if Dewey's alive on Sunday. I think nature's just going to take its course. Look at him.
Dewey show up.
Yeah.
Hey, he showed up last time, and he had no problem showing up and doing this. So, you know, he had no problem putting the rep up to this promo either.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what the hell happens there.
That Rugrats hoodie, huh?
So Steve Jordan said, Johnny Cashmere, send me a message on the flyer so I can post it on my page. Thanks, brother. That's one of the firemen. Thank you, bro. Much appreciated. Is Donnie B coming? Matt Dreamon asks, brother, were you been sleeping on our show? He said last week that he is. It was a big deal, man.
Kayfabe. Brother, yeah. I don't know. You know? Have to wait and see.
Hopefully he'll be there. We don't know.
Though, if, yeah, Fitz and Hoops, if they were there, I was going to give them.
Oh, is that right?
I haven't seen them all.
Fitz, yeah. Fitz and Hoops. Fitz, that sounds like a tag team.
It does.
They were back in the day. They worked. They were at ringside a couple times. They managed on a few shows.
Speaking of tag teams, called.
Yeah, it's true.
They were called something. Not the glamour.
No, they definitely were not the Glamour Girls. It was Fitz, Hoops, and somebody else. They wore like black judges robes or something. I swear to God, I'm not making this up.
Wow.
No, I didn't say that. I'm not going to have the white blazer. Believe me, I'd have to let it out a bit. But no, I do not have the white blazer. I'll just come if I am there, wink, wink, it'll just be me in my ordinary clothes. I will not be participating in the event unless Dewey Donovan sticks his nose and then I might actually run over and rip it off.
Zero chance.
Just because I don't like it. I really don't. That's the truth.
And everyone, there's not going to be a lot of cursing at the show. Just because people are saying the F word on here, it's not going to happen at the show. Unless John Zandig shows up, then F word will be everywhere. So expect
that. Don't give him a live mic.
Let's, right. So let's hear from CXR, by the way. They sent this in, Loke students.
Six teams, two belts, one cage. That sounds like a recipe for something special.
Oh, yeah, baby. You know, six teams?
Yeah.
And one cage?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, that's a lot. You know what? No, we're good. Because you know what? We know at least two of these teams.
Yeah.
One is the BackSeat, who got those pretty belts that we definitely want to take home with us. And we've been to war with those guys plenty of times. So we're no stranger to danger with them. And the other team is our mentors team, HC Loke and Tony DeVito and the Carnage crew. And honestly, I'm honored to be part of this last match with them. And if we have to pin them to get these belts, I'm happy to do that too.
It might be their last dance, but it's our first night as SPO. Tag team champions.
Oh, really? CXR.
Listen, he told you.
You guys
gotta be confident.
You guys might have the honor to be a part of your teacher's last match. All right. But it's also going to be our honor kicking your ass in that cell.
Mm-hmm. Don't forget about our history with you guys, okay? The cage matches, the six-man dog collars, okay? The international feud just got that much bigger, guys.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, guys. Steel cage, man. A lot of, you know, I hope everyone that hears steel cell, they understand it's a steel cage. It's, you're getting free steel cage matches outside.
That's crazy, man. That's so awesome, dude.
Let's check in real quick with the progress here. What's up, brother? Chris, how you doing?
I'm getting close. Some of my pencils fell out of nowhere. I ended up pulling an Urkel.
Oh.
Yeah.
Can I do that?
Look what you did.
I just watched a clip of Urkel dancing with B. Arthur on what must have been some...
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I love you know... every time.
It was awful.
I'm sorry, but
by the way, as a shoot, B. Arthur was like my age when she was on the Golden Girls. I swear to God, I think she was only like 51.
Someone posted a meme. Crazy. Apparently, the guy who plays Urkel, looks more jacked.
Jaleel White,
is more jacked and more in shape than Adam Cole.
The original.
Oh God,
Hedgehog back then in those shows.
Jaleel White, he was Stefan Urkel. He also played his own. Anti like bizarro.
I wonder if he got a double payday for that. Yeah.
Yep.
He worked twice, bro.
That's like working as the Metal Maniac and then coming out as Doink on the same show, wanting a double payday from Dennis.
Yep.
Wait, that never happened, did it?
Never. Oh, brother, daddy.
Stories I have.
If I remember one thing about Urkel, it was one ending of an episode. It involved him being in a video game facing a ninja out of nowhere in the video game. It's like, hi, everyone.
So show us the what you have right now.
All right. If I was Urkel, I would throw ham some cheese.
Wow.
All right. You got the skin tone in. Nice.
Trust me. This
is amazing, dude.
Thank you.
Wow. Sorry, Mitch.
This takes me about a couple hours or even a day if I ever have time, because I mostly help me mama out sometimes.
Ah, nice. Well, my nephew Lucas is watching. Hey, Lucas and Emma.
Lucas, Mitch just said book Donnie versus Dewey. Sorry, Mitch. I took a vow many years ago to never beat up anyone that was handicapped or mentally impaired or obviously physically underwhelming. So I can't do that to the boy.
Before we get to Messiah real quick, guys, we have a few things to mention. All right. So we have our boy WrestlingCAWS on Instagram. Wow. Went ahead and got the Pat Dynamite and the Joe Clean. It's like a 4-pack here. You have a regular Pat Dynamite and a regular Joe Clean, regular attire. And then you have the cinematic match exploding broom closet. Variant attire as well, and they are all available right now on Community Creations in 2K24. Check them out.
Joe Clean looks like he was tanning a little bit there.
I did that with the thing. Yeah, you're right. One's tanner. Right. That's my fault.
Or he's Joe Unclean. Maybe that's the dirty version of Joe.
Could be, brother. So, real quick here, we have another video that I wanted to show you guys. Before we even get Messiah on here, I think it's important we at least show one clip real quick, all right? So people know, in case they haven't seen him in a while. So check this one out.
This is a world championship matchup, not a big Japan death match.
That's rubbing alcohol! That's rubbing alcohol! The Viet Cong used that as torture! He's torturing him!
Oh my!
He's torturing him right now!
Someone's gotta stop this!
So Donnie, one of your favorite wrestlers of all time, the Messiah, isn't he?
I'm not. I don't think I ever met him.
Maybe no, you never met him.
Yeah,
I never heard. But I know how you get when I know how you get when people are like that. So doing that kind of craziness. But for those of you that couldn't see,
the effort. Yeah.
So Nate Hatred had a paint roller on a stick that must have had thumbtacks in it, and he was rolling it up and down Messiah's back after he dumped rubbing alcohol on his back. I mean, come on, man.
Is it really rubbing alcohol? Could he not use just water?
Maybe it was water, but I don't want my back rolled with. So, you know. Yeah. And don't forget, and Zandig used to let the guys in Japan squeeze the lemons and pour the salt on him after he was bleeding. So,
no.
That happened a lot. Guys, before Messiah is supposed to come on shortly, real quick, we have to do our first ever 50 Shades of Wrestling.
Oh man!
Oh man!
I thought this was gonna be a skit for the week. Oh man! So
we're gonna have to do it real quick. So I think we're all gonna have to have a hand in this. Me and the backseats here. And I'm not talking about anyone in particular. This is not meant for anyone. If you think it might have to do with you, then shame on you. All right. So when did guys stop wearing deodorant in the wrestling locker rooms?
More importantly, when did the term spray and go become culturally acceptable in wrestling locker rooms?
And it's not just one place.
Yeah.
It's everywhere. Like, Donnie, I understand you don't, you know, you go, you do a match on a Friday, you're on the road overnight. Maybe you don't get to wash your pads for Saturday. I get it. We used to spray them with Febreze. Febreze had just come out when we were at the height of our first backseat run. And we all thought, the whole America thought, you don't even need to wash your clothes if you have Febreze. Like, we really thought it was that powerful.
You're right.
Right? Right. So we were just spraying, do-do-do-do, and it would get rid of it a little bit. But, man, there's nothing worse than the smell. And then to lock up with someone in a collar and elbow lockup when their elbow pad smells absolutely like rancid vinegar feet smell or something. It's too much, man.
This has actually happened.
What about the women in the locker room? Let me tell you something. I was at training last week with Preacher at the Worldwide Dojo, and he actually sat down and had to tell everyone, like, clean your gear, take a shower, like, have respect for yourself. And if you don't have respect for yourself, have respect for your opponent.
Yeah.
Like, come on.
That wasn't too prevalent in the 90s. I remember, you know what used to be the biggest pain in the ass? They had this stuff. It was called hot stuff. It was in this spray bottle. It was like this burning ass hot shit that everybody put on to make the veins show up a little. It made you red. Like, that shit was so nasty. Guys would spray that all in the fucking locker room and it would get in everybody's eyes and all that. It was called hot stuff.
Yes.
There's no way in the world anybody still uses that today. I don't even think they still make it.
Oh,
if you'd have to be a complete asshole.
Mick Foley got offended last week that someone had it on
the locker room. He did.
Mick Foley did. He said, oh, you can't be having that. People are allergic to it. Blah, blah,
yes. Who had it? Wait a minute. In 2024, somebody had it in a locker room? Did they still make it?
Yeah, yes. I have it. It's in my bag. I still
Johnny
use it.
Johnny made us wear that.
Nobody could be stupid enough to still be using that shit in 2024.
Last year in the beginning.
Yeah, Johnny was very...
vascularity, man. I'll tell you.
Yeah, but it gets in your eyes. It fucks. It's like using OC spray.
It doesn't just get in your eyes, brother. It finds its way you know where.
It's all on me. Oh, whoa. Time out. You're telling me that an indie wrestler in 2024 was dumb enough to spray hot stuff in a locker room?
Yeah.
No fucking way.
Small locker room, too.
No way.
Guess who it was? Guess who it was?
Who?
It was Mike Tarris.
Who?
Mike Tarris.
Oh,
it was Michael Morris. It was Michael Morris.
Oh, that makes sense. Mike has been around forever.
Right.
So that would make sense.
If we want to
put
on hot stuff,
who is Mick Foley? It could still be the same bottle. It could be still the same bottle. I don't know. If he only used it whenever he...
Don't start
I don't know.
That.
I'm asking. Maybe he had a lifetime supply of it.
Nah, dude. Don't get me started with that shit. I'm going to
start don't like the stuff.
Yeah, well.
Well,
yeah. But anyway.
This came from the lack of shower prevalency in various indie locker rooms that we have attended over the last, shall we say, several months in excess. In other words, take a fucking shower.
John Donovan preaches that too. I've heard him say that to students and stuff. That's one of his big hangups.
We have a phrase that we coin in the backseat house called shower tokens.
JP,
I'll allow you to explain a little bit more.
No, not right now because we
got to
move into this
right now.
We got
things to cover.
But yeah, so we saw the high five right there is all of us. A lot more than five of us too. We're great wrestlers, but we're not good at counting, unfortunately. But that's all of us right there. And we were having Messiah Live sketch tonight by Chris, and Chris surprised us and did the entire high five. So that's awesome.
That is crazy.
It is. So I think it's time, guys. Let's get him in here. Dun, dun, dun. And like I said, he's wearing a hat. I called it. Here we go. Messiah.
Wow.
What's up, dude?
How you doing?
How's it going?
What's up, brother? It's so good to see you, man.
Good to see you too, man.
Hell yeah, dude. I don't know if you can hear it or not, but we got a little something going on.
Oh, yeah, I can hear it now.
Yeah. Hook it up.
No, the the version we had was the...
I know.
That,
Nine Inch Nails.
The Nine Inch Nails, yeah. That's one, right. Yeah.
That's right. I forgot. Well, let me introduce you. Mark Sire, you wrote on your name.
Yeah.
That's a typo.
No, that's what Trent used to call me.
Yeah,
that's great.
We did the Mark Sire.
Mark Sire. All
right, so Mark Sire, you know Donnie B. He's the guy that created the back seats.
Yeah, hey, of course. Hey, how's it going, man?
Good,
the
man.
The new back seats here. Big fans of yours, Tommy and JP, the Grayson brothers.
How you doing?
Nice
man?
To meet you guys. Yeah, I've been watching all you guys, the stuff on Facebook and the stuff that Johnny posts. You guys are awesome, man.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Been,
work hard.
You know, always been a follower and admirer of your work, and you know, just the stories that Johnny always tells about you know you guys back in the day. This is tripping me out, man. I'm excited.
Yeah. Berwyn Tavern. Yeah.
P-Wart said Messiah rules. Wrestling Calls from Australia said, "Sup, Messiah."
What's up, man?
Yeah, man. Good
this
stuff.
Is one of the first guys we discovered, like watching on the indies for real. Like it was between Messiah again, the Backseat Boyz, Nick Mondo. You know, it's you know.
Well, speaking of Wrestling Calls from Australia, Messiah, we have a special gift for you that he made, now available in Community Creations on WWE 2K24.
Dude, I am the easiest dude to make.
I know, right?
You and Dreamer.
Seriously, like it's so easy.
Hell yeah. That's awesome. No, that came out really good, man.
That's awesome. No, thank you, man. That's cool.
So before you got on here, I did real quick show a clip of you and Nate Hatred where he runs a paint roller with thumbtacks up your back and then dumps like
rubbing alcohol. Yeah.
How was that, bro?
That was easy only because it wasn't rubbing alcohol, it was water.
Donnie called that.
I just said, please tell me that was fucking water.
Dude, I'm not that dumb. Yeah, I told Nate, I said, make sure you take a sniff of it and go, woo. Like, you know, like it's real. I'm not going to do real rubbing alcohol.
See that? That's awesome.
Dude, I'm all about like
just being safe.
I'm a fan of Bret Hart. I'm all about looking like I get hurt.
You don't do anything crazy in the ring or anything. You don't like.
Well, I mean, yeah. When you're working Nikki, you have no choice.
No. I'm not taking a back suplex from the apron through the ring on a table on cement. That was insane, bro.
Yeah.
But it's not like you do light tubes or anything.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yep. We got you.
That was, we hear you.
It's the West Coast thing. That's probably why.
Can you hear me? I can't hear you guys.
I hear you. Can you hear us?
We hear you.
All right. Hold on. Hold on, Mark Sire. We'll get you in here. Let's check in real quick while he's doing that. Let's check in with Chris. What's up, brother? Chris, we're here. What you got? We hear you, Messiah. I can hear you.
Can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Yes. We can hear you.
I can't hear you guys at all.
All right, hold on. Show him. Hold up your thing and let Messiah see it at least, Chris. I think he's going to get excited to see this.
Test. 1, 2. Rubber ducky. You got my system.
What? I told you this dude's awesome. Yes. Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
I don't know why we can't. Why Messiah can't hear us though?
Check your audio, Johnny. Did you mute him by accident or did he mute?
I don't think so.
That's so cool.
Don't think I did. We're good. That's a mute there. Now he's muted. Now he's unmuted. But I don't know. It's very strange. We'll get him back if we have to. Let me see if I can remove an ad.
Is that better? Can you hear us now? Johnny, you muted him.
Yeah, I think I muted him now.
Yeah.
Technical.
Can't unmute your guest. Their mic isn't connected. So it's saying his mic's not connected, but that's crazy because we just heard him.
If somebody has
the wire in the...
Well, I mean, listen, us wrestlers from the late 90s, early 2000s, we're not good with this new equipment and machinery and stuff. I mean, I can't even do a friggin' Instagram post right anymore.
If only we knew two people that were really good at TikTok and all that shit. Special guests on one day.
That would be wonderful. So, Messiah, we're still having issues with the mic, but that's all right. We'll figure it out. We'll figure it out, brother. Maybe just come off and then come back. Okay, we'll try.
Yeah. Text them on the phone.
Yeah. Yeah. So we'll go off and then try to come back. Let me see how to do that. Yep. There he goes. Yeah. All right. Cool. So.
We'll get him back in just a sec.
Yeah, but like those clips I just showed, like I don't know if you can't see it, like Messiah let Nick Gage give him a back suplex from the apron to the outside of the ring onto cement, and it was like through a table. It was absolutely ridiculous. Brother?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Perfect.
Nice. Sweet.
There you go.
We're back.
I did something on my end. I know I did.
It was Johnny's fault.
Go get your youngest kid to help you and they'll know how to fix it immediately, right? Whatever your youngest is. Yeah.
So
hey, Macy, get over here.
Yep.
That clip that Johnny showed, that was from you and Mondo from the first ever Tournament of Death, the second round. And I think the story around that was that was your first appearance on the East Coast after I guess the incident had happened, and you guys just put on a freaking banger. You did the tilt-a-whirl reversal into the light tube log cabin. It was like I had never seen something like that. That was insane.
What's funny about that is all I did was because I felt bad for Mondo. He's wrestling three times that night. You know, it's a deathmatch tournament, and I just told Mondo, remember the stuff we did in California? It's like, yeah. I said, we'll just do that here. He's like, okay. So it was, it was super easy. It was just, you know, it's like what I used to read about, like guys, you know, guys doing house shows. They just do the same match. I was like, dude, I don't, because I wasn't trying to mess up Mondo or trying to make him remember all this stuff or anything like that. It was like, dude, we'll just keep it simple with what we've done before. We just did different variations on it. Mm-hmm. But Mondo's the one who took all the punishment. Like, dude, I had, I had an easy night that night compared to Mondo.
Mondo's something else, man. I tried to get him on here too. And he's like, Johnny, my head's just so not in wrestling right now. He's like, I don't know how else to put it. You know, he's like, so.
Yeah.
But no, how about you? Where's your head? What have you been doing? A lot of people want to know. And, you know, you don't have to get personal. You say whatever you feel like saying. But, like, what's happened since we've seen you last?
Nothing, man. nothing.
You look good. You're still in shape, bro. Don't act like you're out of shape. I can tell by looking at you, you're not.
No, dude, I got a dad bod. A full-on dad bod, bro. No, dude, honestly, it was just because we had moved to Houston, and then we moved back to California. And when I was living in Houston, I was doing shows in Houston. But, dude, I never took time to, like, actually properly take care of my body. One day I had done a show in Dallas. I forgot the name of the promotion. I think it was XCW. And I used to just do the drive from Houston to Dallas. And I just wanted to be home. I wasn't going to stay the night or anything like that. I'd do my match. I didn't go out to the bars with the guys or anything. It was like, I'm going to head on home because I wanted to, you know, be home with my girls. And it was like, it's like a 5-hour drive one way. I got home like at 6 a.m. Rennell and Shaylee, my wife and daughter, they were sleeping. I couldn't get to sleep. So I started doing some yard work, like moving potted plants. And I moved a potted plant. And it sounded like a shotgun went off. My back just went out on me and I collapsed. And we had a dog. The dog was jumping all over me. I've never been in pain like that in my life. And I was yelling for my wife. And she finally like gets up and she's like, what's wrong? And I couldn't move. And she got me crutches that I had before when I had like messed up my knee or my ankle. But even putting the weight underneath my armpits was put me in more pain. Oof. And dude, I basically was able to, I was literally crawling. And I think after like 2 days, I finally just was like, all right, we need to go to urgent care. So Rennell, my wife took me to urgent care and they stuck like a needle in my hip. And it just, it was a muscle relaxer and it just, you know, so my back wasn't untightening. It was just, I was literally crawling to go to the bathroom and,
oh my God,
my back has never properly healed since then. Mm. I'm sure you know, Johnny, you'll understand, Donnie, you'll understand, you know, you got the two young guys who probably think they can do everything now, but yeah. Like, dude, I was that way. And dude, it got to a point where I would do a match and all I could think about was my back.
Yeah.
And I used to do a lot of things where I'd land on my ass. Mm-hmm. And I think it was the last, when we did the benefit show or the tribute show for Trent, I did that match with Adam. Mm-hmm. Got through it. Everything was fine. And dude, I literally jump off the apron and my back went out. And I remember people in the front row were like, is he screwing around?
Oh man,
dude, my back just went out on me. It's never gone out on me like it did that morning when I got back from Dallas. But it just got to a point where, dude, all I could think about was my back when I would wrestle. Yeah. I was afraid to do this, afraid to do that. And honestly, like, I never gave my body time to heal like it should. Didn't do stretching like I should. And I just got used to being home, trying to let my body heal. People would call and try to book me and I'd politely decline. And then just comes a point where people stop calling.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm happy being home. I mean, I know my wife hates the fact that I'm always home, but like, I'm happy being home. I grew to hate traveling, like getting on an airplane and sitting there for 5 hours. Like, plus, like, a lot of the stuff, I was driving by myself. It's different when you're with a bunch of the boys. and you're talking and you're going over things and you're talking.
Booking the town. Yep.
Yeah, dude. It just being by myself, it was just like all I could do was wait to get home.
Yeah. Mm-mm. Yeah. And we always had our boys too. We were never lone wolves. So it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like I travel with these guys. If I had to travel by myself, I don't think I'd be making a comeback right now either. And the stretching, man, I get it, bro. Stretching. These guys got me stretching. I downloaded an app that I do every day to stretch. So I know I do it. It keeps track. Because, dude, like back then, you're right. We didn't even think we needed it. We were invincible. You know,
yeah.
Just all the bumps we were taking. Dude, I'll never forget. It had to be like 10 years ago. I found the CZW library on their streaming platform. And I was like, I'll pay the $9.99 just to see my old matches. And I remember hitting you up, Billy, of all people. I hit you up immediately and was like, bro, we used to be so good. Like, I see it all with new eyes now. And you were like, yeah, bro, we're good. Like, of course we were good, you know?
Yeah. Well, dude, like, I mean, I'm my biggest critic. Like, I'll pick apart everything I do. I never, it's not like I can honestly say that this was my best match or, I wasn't, you know, like watching Trent, like just seeing someone who was gifted and just,
yes,
dude, like you couldn't teach that. Mm-hmm. You just couldn't teach that. And he would like, you know, he'd be smoking a cigarette in the back and like, and he'd go out there and the light goes on and it's Trent Acid and he's doing this and doing that. And I'd hear you guys going over matches and stuff like that. And it's like, Trent's not going to remember that. Like, I mean, he's not even paying attention right now. Go out there. Boom. He's doing this. He's doing that. You know, I was so envious of that watching you guys. And I've told you this story, like my first match in CZW, when I got the call from Zandy to come in, he had me stay at Nikki's house when Nick and Justice, when they lived together. Mm-hmm. And I met Nikki and super nice. And I'm like, hey, do you got any, tape on Justice Payne? Cause all I knew about CZW, they had a weed whacker.
Right.
That's all I honestly knew, you know? And dude, I wasn't suffering any fools. I knew Zanding was bringing me in. So Justice Payne could go over on me. Cause I was the guy from the West Coast and the porn company thing. And I'm like, dude, whatever. I'm fine with it. It's cool. And, one of the matches that Nikki gave me was Cage of Death 3. And I put it in, and the only thing I was going to watch was Justice Payne's match. But I watched it from beginning to end. I watched every single match. And after watching that, I distinctly remember going, what the hell do they want with me? Like, because all you guys were awesome doing all the stuff you got. It was awesome.
Yeah, but you had psychology and a character, and mm-hmm. a lot of us, like me and Trent, even though we worked, like you didn't look like a kid. Somehow I don't know how to explain it. Even though you were our age, you looked older somehow. So it came off more like me versus Zandig wasn't going to work back then. Trent versus Zandig wasn't going to work back then. You versus Zandig worked back then. It was believable, mm-hmm. in other words.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess it was just... I just remember being like blown away by the whole entire, like the locker room, like all everything you guys were doing. Cause back then, especially, it wasn't like how you got YouTube now and everything. Back then, there really was like a West Coast style and an East Coast style.
Yes.
And unless you were a tape trader or something like that, you never really saw it. And watching it, I was like, dude, like all these guys are awesome. And, I did, you know, I distinctly remember just when I did do the match with Justice Payne. I know I had a good match with him, but dude, I remember like going in the back and like all you guys were like clapping. Mm-hmm. And I remember going, wow, this is a great locker room. Like, holy crap. Like these guys are really nice. And it was like, no, they don't do that. Right. Like Zandy told me, he goes, these guys don't do that. Like it's respect for you. And I came in there like humble, like I introduced myself to everybody and, you know, Adam Flash, the story, he called me a turd. Like, oh, who's this turd? Like, I was like,
I'm shocked.
Yeah, I know. And
bitter. No, not him.
Yeah. I'm like, and what's funny is like I was always taught you introduce yourself, you know, you shake everybody's hand, you go, and what's funny is, Donnie, you'll appreciate this story. Like, I met Nova one time. I know he doesn't like me. I don't know if he remembers me, but I know he doesn't like me.
No, he never mentioned nothing to me, but
Dude, he probably doesn't even remember meeting me. It's after I left XPW, I did a show for UPW, Ultimate Pro Wrestling.
Oh, for Bassman? Okay.
Yeah, for Bassman. I wasn't like they called me. It was a guy named Josh Lazy, who was Sabu's manager in XPW. And Lazy and Rob had like this falling out, and Rob wanted Lazy out of the company and blah, blah, blah. But Lazy left when I left. And I just got a call from Lazy going, hey, you want to go to UPW? I was like, yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah, sure.
That was the place to be.
Yeah, I was like, of course. And keep in mind, like, when I never did the California indie scene. I was just in XPW. Like, it wasn't like I bounced around and knew, like, Frankie Kazarian and these guys.
I was just going to say, I didn't know if you knew Frankie and all them.
Yeah. Like, I didn't meet Frankie until after I left XPW. And when I went into UPW, you know, when I was in XPW, I had, like, my friends. I had, like, Supreme and Kid Chaos and Dynamite D and, you know, my core guys. And very, like, dude, no one was cutthroat. And I've said this in interviews before, like, people ask me, like, how was it when the ECW guys came in? Like, dude, I was so naive, brand new. It wasn't like I was concerned about my spot. I didn't even know I had a spot. I was just happy to be there wrestling. And when I went to UPW, it was completely different atmosphere. The only guy who came up to me and was like, hey, what's up? It's great to have you here, was Hardcore Kid.
Yes.
He was like, what's up, man? I was like, hey, how's it going? Everybody else, like, I remember Smelly, like, just giving me the stink eye and like, who the fuck is this guy? Because we were the XPW, you know, jerk-offs. And
unbelievable, isn't it?
And we went in there, and I didn't, against my better judgment, I didn't go and shake everybody's hand like I was told to. And I was just, you know, I was intimidated by everybody and everything, but I remember Lazy going, don't go up to, don't go shaking their hands. Like, dude, you're Messiah. I was like, who gives a shit? I don't, like, no one cares. Yeah. No one cares.
You've always been so humble, dude. And another thing, I told these guys about you that you have such a discerning eye for wrestling. Like, to sit and study tapes with you made me a better wrestler, period, whether you know that or not. So I was telling these guys, like, if you have any criticism on their work or any of the guys in our locker room over the next couple of months, please let us know, brother, because there's not many guys that can pick shit apart like you can. So I just wanted to say that.
No, I appreciate that. I just, well, to go back to Nova thing. Well, when I was doing my, I forgot who I was working, but like, I remember Bassman's like, oh, Nova's your producer. I was like, okay, dude, I never had a producer before. I didn't like, okay. I knew of them because of, you know, reading the dirt sheets and
WWE. That was rare even on the indies back then. That was rare. Yes.
So I went up to Nova and we wanted to use a chair because I was the guy from the hardcore company or whatever. And I remember telling Nova, like, hey, this is what the match is. We're use the chair. And Nova goes, and he just looks at me. And I had butted in whatever conversation he was having with somebody, unfortunately. And Nova, he just looks at me, he goes, you want to use a chair? I was like, yeah. Can we use a chair? Yeah. You be the chair. I don't know what that means. I have no idea what that means at all.
Cobra Kai shit.
That's so great.
You be the chair. Okay. I don't know what that means. That's the only thing, as far as producing goes, that's the only thing he produced.
I got to text him right now.
That's the only thing he produced that whole night.
Yeah.
Interesting.
He just told me, like, you be the chair. I was like, okay. So we came up with a spot where I think Lazy, like, spit at the guy to distract him or something.
Oh, man.
But, like, after that match, because I, at the time, I was working a shoot job. I was working someplace I had to be, like, at 5 a.m., and I didn't really have any interactions with anybody. I didn't have real interactions with Rick Bassman or anything like that. It was all through Lazy. So like 2 days after, I get a call from Lazy. And essentially it was, yeah, we're done with UPW. I was like, what happened? He goes, it's not going to work out. Apparently, you know, the fact that you didn't hang out and go to the bar or whatever with everybody. Like, dude.
That's so dumb.
And then later on, I remember that there was like, because there was SoCal Uncensored out here.
Yes.
Rick Bassman did like an interview where he said like essentially the most unprofessional person he's ever met was me. And I was excuse me. And what's funny is when I read it, and I mean, I have no problem saying this. When I read it, I had been drinking. So I called up Brian Kendrick, which I had his number, but I never called Brian ever. And then Brian's like, hello. I'm like, hey, Brian, it's Messiah. Hey, what's up? And he, dude, like, I don't even like to introduce myself as Messiah. So that shows you like how much of a, how hot I was.
You're not a mark. Like, yeah. You're not a mark for yourself. Never have.
But been. Like, I was like, dude, I need Rick Bassman's number now. He's like, okay. And he gave me the number. I called Rick Bassman, left him a message. To his credit, he called me back and left me a message. And I just remember going, I don't give a shit. Like, what? Like, I don't care. It is what it is. I mean, to his credit, he called me back.
Yeah.
But it was like, dude, when I think about it, yeah, I didn't, it wasn't like I went and shook everybody's hands and everything, but the fact I didn't hang out after, like, dude, I had to be at work at 5 a.m. Like,
that, you got to understand, UPW was pretty much a breeding ground and a stop if you wanted to get to the WWE. And they knew that. I mean, so all the things that they were doing there with wrestler heat and wrestler court and hanging out and handshakes, hey, brother, worker shake, all that bullshit, that's what was being done up for Vince. That's what they were doing there. So, of course, that was going to translate down to UPW. And that sounds – I wasn't there, but that sounds exactly what happened to you. You were just – you were the – wrong guy, wrong place. They just said, hey, you know, fuck Messiah, we're gonna take it out on him. That wrestler heat, I wouldn't have lasted 30 seconds up there because I would have murdered somebody. But
well, dude, I remember like when, because the first, we did two shows. The first show was just like a promo where Lazy and I walked out, and Lazy and I were getting ready to go out there, and I think I was doing push-ups or something, just trying to psych myself up, and Lazy was my mouthpiece or whatever. But I remember hearing like people go, no one's gonna know who the fuck these guys are. And I, you know, I'm inclined to believe them. Like, why would they know who we are? Like, whatever. But when we came out, we got a, I mean, it was a nice little pop. It was more than I thought we were going to get. But like, oh, then the other thing I remember Lazy, after the match that I had, I can't remember his name, unfortunately, but Lazy got mad. He got mad at me for something. I forgot. I did something. And he's like, you shouldn't have fucking done that. Like, dude, you're Messiah. And then Smelly was walking by. He goes, you know what I mean, Smelly? And Smelly just like, get the fuck out of here, guy. Like,
Jesus.
And Lazy was a night. Lazy is a super nice guy. So it was just, I just had heat because I was the XPW guy coming in, and I did the one thing wrong, which I should have.
Anybody who came into that Shark Tank back then, you were a guy who was over, you had some steam, you know, you were a little well known. So of course you're coming in there and all those guys are looking at you going, oh shit, another guy we got to contend with to get out of Rikers here. And that's exactly what happened.
Mm,
I mean, I haven't thought about that stuff in years. Like, it's so surreal thinking about it. And then like coming over to CZW where it was like, I remember like Trent, the first show, after the show, Trent came up to me. And you know, I think he said good match. I can't even remember if he said that, but he said, "So what is XPW saying about CZW?" And I was like, "Nothing. I didn't even know. Like, I don't have a computer, so I don't know. Like, dude, I don't know what's like. I didn't know anything. It was just and John, you know, John brings me in, but then it's like, dude, don't be, you know, because you know how John was. He, you know, he's trying to play it down and everything. Like, dude, don't. It's okay if no one knows who you are. It's not a big deal. It's not about that. Just, I was like, then why did you bring me over here if no one knows who I am? Like, okay. Like, all right.
He was worried about your self-esteem, brother.
Yeah, sure he was. Yeah. John.
So real quick, let me do a little bit of housekeeping. Chris, Sierra, we're going to check in with you in 1 minute. Billy, sit tight 1 minute. Donnie, I know you have to leave at 10. If you have to go, go. No problem at all.
We'll keep going. I'm good.
Because we have a message from Silk City Kings. That's the only tag team going in the Scramble this Sunday. I have not played yet, so we're going to play this. And then we'll be right back to check on the sketch and right back with the Mark Saya.
Ayo, SPO. It's the Silk City Kings.
Kenny Bangle.
Bulldog Pittman.
And we just wanted to let y'all know that on April 7th,
Mania Weekend,
in Burlington, New Jersey,
in that six scramble cell match.
Six teams will enter.
One team will leave.
The new SPO Tag Team Champions.
Not one team.
The Silk City Kings. Hey, yo, Messiah. We see you, my boy. Big SCK.
All day.
Ooh. Messiah. Nice. I told you, bro. The new people like you.
Oh, thanks.
See why I waited to play that when you were here.
No, I appreciate that, dude.
Yeah, brother. You know it. So, oh, my God. So, anyway, so let's check in with Chris real quick. Chris, meet the Messiah. This is Chris.
Damn it. Did I knock myself out again?
Oh, no.
No, you're here, bro.
No, he can't hear
us. Can you hear me?
No.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, we hear you.
Yep.
But you can't hear us. All right, Chris, let's see some progress. How's it going, brother?
While barely
figuring it all out. What we got?
Wow.
Holy shit.
Damn.
Oh, there we go. Nice.
I love
That's
it.
That's insane.
That's so cool.
That is awesome.
Thank you.
Look, That's Flash amazing. Is definitely Adam Flash. You know, Messiah, you're talking about landing on your butt. How does Flash still walk after all those leg drops off of everything high?
Dude, I wish I knew because, dude, I know what screwed up my back. It's when I used to do the springboard leg drops.
Yep.
Mm.
Dude, that's what messed up my back. I know it is.
Well, Chris, yeah, I want to say thank you.
Leg drop, bro.
Yo, seriously, Chris, thank you. It's awesome. The Trent one was awesome.
That was so cool. Thank you, man.
Yeah,
thank you.
Real quick, bro, before I let you go, I want to real quick show everyone again. We got the Trent Acid that you drew, and we got the Channing Decker. You'll see Channing Decker this Sunday. He's down from Canada, but he's also got Mondo. He's got Briscoes. He's got Janella. He's got so many badass ones. So check him out at indie wrestling art_2 on Instagram, and check out his work. And Chris, you know what? Maybe on the episode before our events, our Taking It Home episode, if you will, every month, we can have you sketch someone if you're up for it, bro. That'd be awesome.
Well, let me think about it for a minute. Hell yeah!
The Donnie B, bro. We're gonna get you the Don Johnson outfit and the suit.
90s okay? version, please, not the current one. Yeah,
the 90s version of Big 80s Donnie B is what we need.
I'll give you the appropriate material to copy.
Thank you, brother. And send that to me so I can put it out on our stories and make sure Messiah gets a copy of it. All right, brother?
All right.
Thank you, Dark King. Have a great one.
Yeah, thank you, man. That was really cool. Yeah,
thank you.
Some awesome.
Brother.
Talk soon, brother.
Johnny, I got to say, man, I got to just say it for a second. You're 2 for 2, man. Rick Blade. And now Messiah. What's cool about this is I didn't know Messiah too well, but I know his whole deal and the story. And just the fact that you're here, bro, and you're alive, and you were just talking about like your wife and daughter, and after all these years, all the shit you've been through, you could have easily went down the road of villainy or debauchery and gimmicks and been laying in a ditch. Or you know what I mean, man?
Yeah.
Another sad fucking story. And the fact that you're here. It's just cool to me, bro. All the guys that have been done themselves in by their own hand, you didn't wind up like that, bro. You persevered, iron forged iron. You came out the other side. You're a good, productive member of society. That's what I like about the wrestling business from guys who back in yesteryear from our time. But if JP and Tommy, if you could take nothing else by the guy sitting right there in the lower left corner, the fact that he's here and he's upright. And he's a productive husband and father and a good human being overall. That's the fucking real story of the Messiah, dude. He really is the Messiah. You know what I mean? He came back. Seriously, bro. You resurrected and came back. A lesser man would have fucking burst into flames and we never would have heard of you again. It would have just been like, oh yeah, I remember that guy. Like, and that would have been a sad end to the story. But I'm really happy for you, bro. Hopefully someday I'll give you a handshake and we'll meet face to face. And I'm proud of you, man. I really am.
No, I appreciate it, bro. I mean, I attribute everything to, you know, my wife and daughters and, you know, and honestly, like, dude, like everything happened, you know, the tag thing that happened to me, that happened after I had joined CZW. And I don't think I can emphasize this enough. When I was in CZW, like, and like I said before, it wasn't like I had done the California indie scene before XPW. I just, you know, I, for lack of a better word, I fell into to XPW just because, hey, you wanted guys that I knew were wrestling. It's like, okay, cool. And when I went to CZW, all I knew was XPW. So when I went to CZW, I mean, quite honestly, like my confidence was shot. So when I went into the locker room and having guys like Johnny and Trent and Adam Flash and Ian Knox, all those guys be so welcoming and, you know, bring me in, and my confidence started coming back up, and it was like, no, dude, I can do this. It's not like I need to be, have that XPW machine pushing me. Cause you know, I didn't know it at the time. It wasn't until I left XPW. And like I said, it's not like I had a computer where I could go online and look at things and find out things about myself or see what people are saying. And I didn't have it.
We had Z-Bar for that.
Yeah. Z-Bar. But like when I left XPW, like I didn't know, like apparently I had heat on me from a lot of guys in SoCal, because it was like, who's the kid that hasn't essentially been paying dues, wrestling Sabu and Chris Candido and, you know, and New Jack, like, and there was one guy who I'm not going to say his name now, but I met him. He's a super nice guy, but like he went as far as to like use my finisher in SoCal and like make sure people like kicked out on one.
Oh.
Dude, like I didn't know, like I had no idea I had heat on me. Like I was just wrestling. Like,
you're not the only one that went through that. You know, Nick and Chris went through, Nick and Justice Payne went through that with NWA yeah. New Jersey. Donnie, remember when you guys booked them for Pine Hill and they insisted on jumping off the top of that thing? And you guys were like, what is wrong with these guys? They were treated the same way on the East Coast like that, bro. It was just
really, yeah.
Business, it's like the business changed, but no one got the memo. You know,
yeah,
bro, it's even changed again since then. Like now you can work the right side in America. When you take a tackle, you're not definitely getting up left over right, because if the guy runs straight, you got to get up the other way. So now your mind's like, shit, well, I never had to think of this before. And then you're in a locker room and the guy says to you, well, I'll hit you with the Jay Lethal and then I'll hit you with the Mark Briscoe. And you're like, I don't know these moves by the name of the wrestler.
Real quick, so, and then sure. Messiah know this guy, but it was a match once. It was a Rockin' Rebel versus Lupus, and I'm ringside, and he's backing him into the ropes, and as he whips him off, he goes, Rebel Sizer. He goes, Rebel Sizer, and Lupus goes, what? As he's getting whipped into the ropes, had no idea what it was. But this motherfucker just said Rebel Sizer like it was Cher or Madonna.
Yeah.
Like the whole world knew what this scumbag was going to do. I hated Rebel. Yeah, I don't care.
It was a clothesline, by the way.
Ghost.
Yeah. Rebel Sizer is
Rebel Sizer.
Clothesline is two syllables. He
swear
added
to God.
Two syllables.
Swear to God, he said Rebel Sizer, and Lupus just goes, as he's getting whipped through the ropes. God almighty.
One of my favorite things to do was after shows, Johnny remembers this, where we'd go to your house or we'd go to Ian's house and we'd watch like the tapes of like the fuck ups and the screw ups.
Oh.
Dude, that was the fat guy falling was the best one.
Oh God.
But
we showed that at the first PW show on the closed circuit TV. Yeah. We showed that Hunk Heiser falling off the top rope twice, dude. That was too much.
Dude, anytime I see that, I just I hear like Trent in my head, like just cackling at that shit, going like,
and hurt
the shits.
Hurt the kid jumped off the top to the outside, and no one caught him, and he's like 100 pounds, and he landed on the rocks. Do you remember that?
Oh. Yeah.
We were in Japan rewinding that and watching it slow. We pretty much broke the VHS.
Yeah, like dude, that I love that stuff. But like, dude, what I was gonna say before was being in CZW, being around like Trent and Johnny and all those guys, like it brought my confidence. I can't explain the fact that like in XPW, I wasn't aware of having a spot. I wasn't aware of that my spot could be taken or anything like that. It wasn't like I was politicking to be in that spot or anything. So when I left and went to CZW, it really was like a breath of fresh air and having guys like you, Johnny, and being around and everything. And then especially after the attack. Like, Johnny knows this, dude. There was times that there was weeks I didn't go home.
Yep.
I just stayed in Philly.
Mm-hmm. We got you working the door at the tavern even, right? You were making money in Philly. Yeah.
Yeah. And then I eventually moved to Philly. And it was, dude, I honestly don't think of, if I didn't have you guys around me around that time, that I'd be here right now. It's the same here. I needed to be out of California or just being away from whatever it was. You guys were like, I mean, all of you guys were really just good for my soul.
Yep.
You know,
and like vice versa, man. You've always been special to me, Ian. We're trying to get Ian to come back around, and dude, of course I want you to come back. And even if you can't wrestle, whatever, you know, you have the golden ticket. Anything I'm ever a part of, I told Rick Blade the same thing, and now GQ is coming back. We're training.
That's cool. Ring.
Dude, it's like, if you know, I didn't know about your back that it was that bad. I had no idea. But dude, just the way you've been talking, like, you could be a commentator, bro. You could be a general manager. You could be a backstage interviewer. You could have your own podcast. You could do watch alongs to your old matches, bro. Stuff like that. There is a market for the Messiah today. And everyone that you're looking at right now will help you tap into that. Not even for money. If you want to make money, great. But just because, bro, we need it. I don't know how else to explain it. It lights us up from the inside. I know you have your family and everything, so no pressure. But you know that it the door's always more than wide open for you, my bro.
Dude, IO says, I appreciate one that. More match, bro, in the chat.
Well, like, straight up, like, I just don't want to stink up the joint. That's all it is, man. I just don't want to stink up the joint.
Stop it. Stink up the joint.
Like, dude, what's funny is after I did, like, Dark Side of the Ring, I was at work, and this guy comes up to me, and he's like, can I ask you a question? I was like, yeah, what's up? And he goes, I thought he was going to ask, like, for directions someplace or something, or, hey, how do I get here? Or ask me. he looks at me, he just goes, are you Messiah? And I was like, yeah. He's like, dude, I watched Dark Side. I was like, sorry, man. Sorry you watched that. He's like, no, it's cool. Like, are you wrestling anymore? I'm like, nah, man. He goes, you don't do conventions? I was like, no one's going to want to freaking pay to meet you. What? Like, dude, like, no, I don't do conventions. I mean, I appreciate you, like, saying what you know, being as nice as you are, but no, man. Like,
your dues, man. And let me tell you, we didn't know you weren't confident when you came in. CZW was like a box of Crayola crayons with one crayon missing, and no one knew what color it was until Messiah fit right into that spot. No, I'm serious. Wow. I'm dead serious. It completed it, bro. It was like the dark crystal. It was the last little piece we needed in there to make the whole thing. And then it just boom. And that's what we're trying to do again with SPO, with SPO. And I told these guys, I was like, see, everyone remembers, oh, Trent was awesome or Wife Beater was awesome. But back then it was, we were all awesome. When one guy got attention, all of us got attention. We all rose up together because we all looked out for each other. We were humble. We weren't trying to cut each other off, blow anyone else's candle out to make our shine brighter. That was
absolutely.
And I'm trying to instill that. And these guys already know that. Donnie instilled that in me. John was at our first show, meeting in the locker room, talking.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
You know, so, like, I know you're in California and I know you're not going to be at the show this Sunday or anything, but open ticket, you're always welcome anytime. You can come on here with us anytime. I know you're busy. Dude, you need to be involved in wrestling. You're too valuable not to, and you still have too much to offer. I can see it in your eyes, so don't even try to. I
appreciate it, dude. Like, dude, I try to. Dude, what's funny is, like, I did a show for Danny Demento, like, in October or something like that. He just wanted me to, he was out here doing I forgot the name of his promotion, but he just wanted me to do a run-in. And I know why he won, because he was having an issue with Rob and XPW. Like, I get it. You're bringing me in just to piss Rob off. I have no problem with that.
Take me in yet.
But I went and I didn't realize how much, like, I missed being around everybody and seeing, like, people I haven't seen in years and meeting new people. And it was fun. I enjoyed it. And, What's funny is, like, even, like, where I work and people ask me questions about wrestling or like guys I went to high school with that I don't even speak to, but just keep in contact through on Facebook. I get sent like videos of wrestling, or, and it's usually like botches or something. But like, dude, yeah, this really like hurt this guy. I'm like, yeah, no, that really hurt that guy. Like, no, yeah. Dude, I always enjoy, I mean, I still enjoy watching wrestling. I enjoy, I would love to be part of it. Just to, you know, whatever it means, picking my brain or something like that. Like, I would love to be able to do that. Yes.
We will do that.
But it's just always been a case of, dude, I don't like leaving the house.
I don't blame you.
I'm such an old man, bro.
We have a Tron. Bro, we got a Tron. We can have you live via Tron.
There you go.
It'd be over, bro. But no, listen, man, just know that over the next few weeks, if things start happening in your life that are coincidences that keep telling you, like, go back in this direction, go back in this direction, all I ask is that you take notice and you listen. Because if the universe wants you to do this, you're going to do it, brother. Just like the Messiah being on here the day after Easter, on April Fool's Day. It's like all these weird coincidences.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Right. So
appreciate it.
But yeah, dude. Yeah. Let me real quick, just real quick, I want to let Donnie go, but check it out. You can buy tickets at spowrestling.com for Endgame. It's already here. I can't believe this is the go home show. We've been doing this now since before Thanksgiving, and this is like our first season, and our first two events were successes going into this third event, and we're trying something new with the cages outside, and it might work as far as people might love it, and a bunch of people might show up. We might have the whole town there, or who knows, but the point is we're trying. Yep. We're trying to do things different. We're trying to yell as loud as we can. And as you can see, the guys in the locker room are excited. They're working hard. And I just want to see this work for them. So, Billy, if Messiah, you ever do come on board, it's going to be the same deal again. You're coming into a place that's there ready to welcome you with open arms. So, and this time you don't have to
I appreciate
insecure.
It, man.
You don't have to be insecure this time because you got a whole lifetime of work behind you that proves your worth and value times 10, brother. Mm-hmm.
I appreciate it, man. Yes, like, people ask me like sometimes like what my favorite thing is that I've done or whatever. And honestly, it's never been a match. It's never been a specific thing. It's always been the fact that I was able to get like you and Trent booked out in California and got Beater and Flash out here. And like the fact that I was able to get my friends to, you know, to talk to some promoter and like, hey, you need to bring these guys in. Yeah. I was always like super proud of being able to do that.
Hell yeah. Mm-hmm. We loved coming
That's
out
awesome.
There. Remember?
Yeah, man.
California was so much fun hanging with the Messiah. We went to that place called the Greens where they brought the buckets of beer out while you were.
Oh, about- yeah, yeah. We went to Magic Mountain too. I remember that. We went to Magic Mountain.
Too.
Yeah.
Riddler's Revenge, I was on. That was awesome. Yeah.
And B-Boy was too scared to go on a roller coaster.
Yes! Didn't like heights. Yeah. He was too scared. Actually, shit, I forgot to mention. Last week we didn't do this, so I got to say it right now. Speaking of the Riddler, Dewey Donovan promises a surprise. Oh. Yo, Messiah, he straight up managed these two guys last show and turned on them, went with the rep, all kinds of shit. Dude, he's like out to get, he's mad that I created Backseat Boyz without him, blah, blah, blah. So we're in this big feud now, brother. It's going really
Dewey never turned on me. So, I mean, I
give him time.
Yeah.
Watch. Punch me in the nuts. Yeah.
Dewey still got it, man.
He ain't got nothing.
Messiah, that promotion out in Cali, epic. Was that the promotion that New Jack had that speech on? Correct.
Yeah. Yeah,
that was the end. The locker room speech that had all you guys. Johnny and Trent were out there. B Boy and everyone. They're not still active out there, are they?
Epic? No, not at all. No. What's funny is that's the fuck.
Sorry if I opened up a can of worms.
No, not at all, dude. Not at all. It was that's the promotion where I spewed my stupid thing that I said that she loved it. I never meant to say that. Dude, I never meant to say that. It was one of the instantly when I said it, it was like, why did you say that? It was especially back then, I was an angry like 23-year-old kid, dude. Like I just, and especially like with dealing with like Rob Black and all the threats he was always sending my way, and I would hear like new rumors that were coming out of that place that I know he was starting. And dude, I reached a boiling point.
Yep.
And I mean, as much as Dark Side of the Ring, even though I was hoping they wouldn't do it, as much as they want to say the reason I got attacked was because of what happened with Lizzie, it really wasn't. The reason I got attacked was because I wasn't scared of Rob. It was because Rob was so used to being able to intimidate guys. And
like he held your career in his hands.
It wasn't even, well, I know when I left XPW, it was a case of, we're not going to hear from Billy anymore.
Right.
He's gone. He's out of here. And then I went to CZW. And then ironically, like people who worked in the office that I was still friends with were telling me that Rob was always checking up on what I was doing. And then it's like, I'm in CZW for however many months it was. And I was CZW heavyweight champion. And then it was like, I was getting traction out there. And then on top of the fact, like I said, like I never meant to say anything. It was just Rob was, I was hearing some new rumor that was coming out of that office that of course was painting me in a horrible light.
Yep.
And I was being told like, you know, essentially, you know, Rob was trying to run me out of California or whatever it was. And I refused to be intimidated by him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I know he hated it. And the fact that I went to that XPW show with Mondo that I never expected, that I never even wanted to go, but Mondo's like, let's go to the show. Let's go to the show. I was like, all right, dude, let's find out. And I got free tickets from Smiley, who now works in WWE, ironically. Showing up at that show was the straw that broke the camel's back from what I was told with Rob. And then like a week later is when I got attacked. Had nothing to do with Lizzie. Lizzie played a very small part in that. It was the fact that I was supposed to be afraid of Rob, and I wasn't. And every opportunity I had to show Rob that I wasn't afraid of him, and that included opening my stupid mouth when I shouldn't have. It was just, yeah, I what happened to me sucks. You know, it is what it is. Part of me in the back of my mind probably thinks I deserved it. But I wasn't about to, I wasn't going to allow it to stop me from doing what I wanted to do. And that was to wrestle.
Right. And you're a survivor, dude. You've been through a lot of shit that no one should ever have to go through. And that was in a time where PTSD and all this shit was not understood. It's really still not understood. Let's be honest. So you're probably triggered by stuff and don't even realize it, bro. Like, dude, you got your shit together. I'm friggin' impressed as hell that you have had your life the way it's been your whole life. You know me, bro. You know what my mouth got me in trouble a million times.
Yeah.
Dude, you're someone that's always been stable, has always been someone that I've looked up to, and I've always seen you like a rock, man. And believe me, I know I've turned my back on my friends in my past, but Billy, you know, you mean a lot to me, man, and you always have, and our whole group does. And, you know, when GQ was telling me he talked to Ian, and Ian might come to the next show, I was like, what? Like, fucking right, get him to the next show.
Yeah,
dude, to have you guys around again and like for us all to be dealt the same hand at the same time, it's because we all have something to offer the next generation, bro, and because a lot of them are actually willing to listen to what we have to say, believe it or not. They grew up watching us from the crowd, a lot of them, God bless them, you know.
That's like that's really cool. Like I'm so removed from wrestling, and again, it's not necessarily by choice, it just kind of happened. It wasn't like I was trying to get away from the business or anything like that. Just it's life, you know? Yeah, dude, I appreciate everything you're saying, dude. And whether I knew it or not, it's probably something I needed to hear.
Good.
And I really do appreciate it. Thank you, man.
Good. Well, let's make what I'm going to call right now an end game pact, me and you, right? That you're going to try to do more with wrestling in the next few months. All right.
Yeah,
try to start letting it in your life a little bit more. Keep the door a little bit open and see what happens.
Yeah. Well, dude, it's fun. Like I try to get my daughter to watch wrestling with me and she's like, no.
Yeah. But when you're on it, she will.
Well, yeah. Dude, every now and then I'll be like, hey, look at this. And I'll show her something. And usually, unfortunately, it probably has like blood in it or something. And she's just like, right. Ew, and like, no. And
Yeah, well, anyone that's watching, if they don't know, you're not a blood and guts wrestler. You are a good wrestler. You do great wrestling matches, psychology, the whole nine yards. And when you came in to CZW, that's probably not what you were hired for. And suddenly you pulled out this whole other tool set that no one even realized you had. Or maybe you didn't even realize you had it, but you had it. And
well, dude, what's funny is, like, dude, I'm known because, like, I was inducted into, like, the SoCal Deathmatch Hall of Fame.
Right.
And I mean, I was on it, and even why am I blanking on his name right now? GCW. They have their Deathmatch Hall of Fame.
Mondo's in it.
Yeah, I can't believe I'm blanking on his name.
Lauderdale?
Yeah. Dude, he's asked me, last year he didn't ask me, but like the 2 years prior, he was asking, he wanted to induct me, and I declined both years. I just couldn't do it.
Dude, I'm back because I helped induct Mondo into that very Hall of Fame, bro.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I met people that night, made friends, came back into the business. You don't know how shit happens, man. If he's already asked you twice, yo, GCW is a big friggin' deal, bro. You do that.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Next year.
What's funny is, like, dude, I don't know if they think because I'll say, like, I've never considered myself a deathmatch wrestler, even though, like, I am known for doing deathmatches. Right. Dude, I'm more like, dude, if you want to call me hardcore extreme, absolutely. Like, I'm raised on ECW.
Right.
I wouldn't call Sabu a deathmatch wrestler.
No.
You know, like, dude, he was a hardcore extreme guy. Mm-hmm. So it's like when I get labeled the deathmatch, it's like that's fine. It's not insulting to me, especially when you consider what these guys do now.
Mm.
Like, dude, I'm not doing razor blades and, like, I did crazy. I'm not saying I didn't do crazy shit.
In cans.
Like,
I
absolutely did. But I didn't do the stuff that they're doing now. And I know, like Zandig used to call IWA hack and slash.
Yeah.
You're like, you know, they're hack and slash. We're, you know, we don't do hack and slash. We got psychology. And, like, and I was always, I was always a big proponent of, like, you know, teasing things, whether it's setting up a table in the corner and then you forget about it.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you go through it. And, like, I always like doing that stuff.
You didn't do hardcore in PW hardly. What did we?
No,
in PW. Yeah.
It was just and you know, I never, my tangent meaning, like, that I was going into, I have no problem being called a deathmatch guy. I just never considered myself a deathmatch guy. I've done death matches, but I grew up a Bret Hart fan. I wanted to be Bret Hart.
Oh yeah.
And the only reason I did death matches was the next PW when they had the first deathmatch tournament. Walked in for the usual company meeting and, like, hey, we're doing a deathmatch tournament. There's the whiteboard. If you want to volunteer, go for it. Or put your name up there. And my trainer and I, Carlos, be cool to say I did a deathmatch once.
Wow. That's how it happened.
Yeah. It was like, okay. And then, so I signed up for it and I did well because, dude, I just went balls to the wall. Wasn't like I tippy-toed around anything. All of a sudden I was put in a feud with Supreme, who was the deathmatch king, and then I'm doing death matches.
Yep.
And I never complained about it. I never said I don't want to do it. The only time I ever said, dude, I really prefer not to do that stuff, is when I left CZW that first time.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I think Ruckus beat me for the heavyweight title, which I got knocked out in that match. I don't even remember doing that match.
Whoa. And,
dude, if you watch the match, if you see it, he does like that razzle dazzle thing on the outside,
and he lands on it.
Yeah, his knee landed on me, and for whatever reason, that particular show, like, there was no mats outside,
mm-hmm.
and my temple went into the concrete.
Ooh.
And dude, I don't remember anything of that. I don't remember doing that match. I've seen the match. I know what's supposed to happen. But it didn't, because I'm watching it. I'm just on autopilot.
Yeah.
And I guess that's right when Smart Mark Video took over the booking for CZW. I can't remember his name. The guy who used to own Smart
Mike Mark. Burns. That's when I left.
Yeah, Burnsy. Yeah, it's right when you left.
Mm-hmm.
And I got the call from Burnsy just going, hey. Yeah, and I remember he was he's being all non. He didn't want to hurt my feelings. He's just like, yeah, because his whole thing was, we're putting the belts on everybody new.
Right.
and we're going in a different direction. That's when Super Dragon started coming in, and Excalibur, and those guys.
Yep. SIERA, like, okay.
Yeah. And I just remember I finally on the phone had to go, dude, you're not using me anymore.
Right.
He's like, yeah. I was like, okay, I'm a big boy. I got it. I can take it. Like, yeah. It's fine. And talking to Zandig later on, his idea was to then put me into that ultraviolet underground.
Right.
Because the athletic mission came in and they couldn't do the light tubes and all that shit. And I'm like, dude, I don't want to do that.
Yeah. Unreal, man.
You know, so
you did Pandora's Box, right? With you and Flash and Sanjay.
Yeah, we came back. Well, what's funny is Trent and Johnny, if I remember right, Trent and Johnny were going to be doing a show in California. And when they left CZW, I mean, I'll be quite honest. There was a void. You know, those guys were no longer there. Those guys were a big part of the locker room and having the fun, just the fun in the locker room and everything. So there really was this void. And when guys like Super Dragon, this isn't talking bad on Super Dragon and those guys, but when Super Dragon came in and Excalibur and the West Coast guys who I knew, but when they came in, there really was a divide in the CZW locker room.
Same. Yeah.
Whereas before there really was no divide. All Never. Of us hung out with each other. Like there was no, like a, there wasn't a click thing.
No, there wasn't. No, there wasn't. You're right.
And again, those guys came in and it's not like they were trying to be a-holes about it. Dude, they were with their friends. You know, it's like, I completely understand it.
Yep.
And
exactly.
I remember Trent and Johnny Trent and Johnny, I think we're coming out to California to do a show. And I heard that they were coming out. I called Johnny. I was like, hey, I heard you guys are coming out here. Like, you want to hang out? And Johnny, they had just started PWU. Or maybe it was you were with 3PW too. I can't remember.
Something like that. Yeah, it was.
And Johnny, I remember talking to you on the phone. You're like, yeah, we come out. We can hang out. Like, okay. I hang up the phone with you. And then maybe 10 minutes later, you called back and you went, I'm paraphrasing here, but your words were like, I'm trying to think to myself, was my friend trying to ask me if I could come work for you? I was like, wait, what? Like, dude, I just wanted to know if you wanted to hang out when you were out here.
You were trying to book me, brother. I wanted to talk money probably.
And I was like,
I don't even remember that.
Big surprise. I was like, no. Like, he's like, well, dude, do you want to come out to PWU? I was like, yeah, sure. I'll do PWU. I'm not in CZW anymore. Like, okay, cool. Well, I just want to know if you wanted to hang out when you guys were out here. That's how I got into PWU.
Well, so I'm going to start saving. I'm going to start saving for your flight from California.
Yeah, brother.
We can get you out here, brother. Pinch my pennies. We're all going to need in a
that,
quarter.
Dude. You don't need to do that, bro. Yeah. I appreciate it, but you don't need to save your money for that.
Dude. Oh, I know. It's just kidding. But no, dude, we got to get you out here ASAP. And bro, I'm sensing a part two with Messiah has to happen. And
yeah, definitely.
Because I agree.
You got a lot to talk about. And now I think next time I'll have even better questions ready for you now that I see you're up for anything. I like it. See, I didn't know what I was going to get.
Sounds good.
So,
dude, I've never, when I've done interviews, I've said this before, but it's probably a form of therapy for me. I just spew.
Yeah, no, that's cool.
Sometimes after it, I'll be like when I did Dark Side of the Ring, I just remember driving home going like, shut the fuck up, Billy.
Nah, dude, you're
like, dude, what the fuck?
You're excited, dude. And if I sense it, I feel it. You have an exuberance that only comes from getting that rush back in from wrestling and everything. So, brother, do your thing, man. Thank you for being on.
Yes.
We appreciate
you, brother.
I appreciate you guys having me and letting me just spew.
This was the most anticipated episode.
Yes.
Dude, the Messiah. I can't thank you enough, man. Everyone, thanks for staying up late with us. 10:30 almost here. That's it. Get to SpoWrestling.com. Buy your tickets, your general admission tickets for Endgame Part 2 inside, because outside's free. At 2:30, be there at the firehouse for the two big steel cage matches, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Don't worry, Messiah. It will be live streamed. So you can check it out.
Definitely, man.
So 3 hours early. So it'll be 11:30 for you. Nice. But yeah. So Messiah, brother, love you. Thank you. Have you back soon. God bless. Send my love to the family, please.
Of course. Yeah. Renell wanted to say, she's like, yeah, tell Johnny I said hi. I was like, okay, of course.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Thank you guys for having me on. It was great meeting you guys. And thank you, brother, for allowing me to just to talk. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for coming on, Messiah. It was a pleasure.
Of course, man. Of course.
Yep. God bless.
Good luck this week. All
right. Thank you.
Awesome, guys. Wow. Nice Donnie guy. You stayed up late, Donnie.
Bro, I think I talked to him once, maybe at a Mimi show or the 3PW thing. Was he forever for that or Trent's thing?
He was definitely was he a Trent thing with us, yeah.
Maybe it was that where I met him. I know I had like a hey, brother, it. How you been conversation. That was it.
No, that would have been it. That would
he was
been
definitely
it.
Cooler than not that I thought he was going to be an asshole, but he was definitely a cool guy.
Oh yeah, definitely. And Bufa Ayo was in here. He just said facts. Yeah, Bufa.
Big mark mm-hmm. for Bufa. Yeah. I love Bufa. I saw Bufa online say he was here until the end of April and he was looking for bookings. I'm thinking to myself, how the fuck is his calendar not completely full?
Yeah,
like,
I don't.
What
get
is
it.
Going on? Like, remember I said this last week about guys. Like,
yep,
Bufa's in there too.
Yep, Bufa versus Mo Jabari is going to happen Sunday. That's the international incident. We also have Dan Moff versus Lucky. Rick Blade's going to talk about his future. We have the 15 minutes of fame rumble. God knows what's going to happen. Winner gets a future.
Wear deodorant.
Oh. Wear soap on a rope match.
Wear deodorant in the 15 minutes of fame so you do not wind up in the 50 Shades of Grey the next night.
So it's 15 minutes of fame battle royal or Royal Rumble, Donnie. It's strong enough for a man, but pH balanced for a woman.
Uh-oh.
That's over. And then me versus Jordan, the match Donnie made. The backseat legacy is on the line here. And then, of course, the exploding broom closet cinematic match, Joe Clean.
Oh, so awesome.
At Dynamite. And don't forget their calls are available right now, along with the Messiah call, all on Community Creations for 2K2. And guys, it's going to be the last ever Carnage Crew match. Bobby Fish is going to be there for DeVito's last match to honor him. We have That's Live cool. Danger and the Batman of Burlington. And of course, the coup de grace, the main event, Homicide versus Scorpio. Let's not forget the cage matches. The women are going in for the title. Rebecca Scott, Christina Marie. The big 6-team scramble cell, the Backseat Boyz silver scramble cell with the Carnage Crew's last match, Silk City Kings, Golden Era Rep and CXR, and of course, Sunny Kiss.
Very cool.
To the event for free.
Stacked.
Boom.
I think it's the show of the weekend. I really do. I know there's a million shows in the tri-state area. Everybody's got a lineup and everybody's working, everybody's booked, but I'm just saying, man, to me, this is the event of the weekend. That's Sunday. You'll be home plenty of time for WrestleMania. It's going to be great, man. Can't wait
Don't
to see
forget,
it.
These belts are going to be on the line in the silver scramble cell match. Don't think they're going anywhere, okay? Rep Dewey Donovan, our business with you is completely separate, but these, they're going nowhere.
Uh-oh. Nice.
Part one quick, free, part two, get your tickets now.
So guys, real quick, we got to talk. Donnie, if you want to go, you can go. We're going to be about another 5 minutes.
All right, gentlemen, I'm going to bid you adieu. I need my beauty sleep. I'm 51 years old. All right, guys, it was a pleasure. Right, I'll see you on the show.
Good night, B. Thank you.
Good night.
So guys, real quick, hey, we said it was going to be a super long show, and if people can't stay up with us, they can watch it and listen to it anytime. But real quick, we do have to talk about a few things. So I want to talk about this past weekend. We had a really good weekend at Loud East Wrestling. Here's a picture of the house at Ridgefield Park. They had a really good crowd and a great locker room. It was really exciting. Grim Reefer is running just a badass event. Mm-hmm. Homicide on the event. Jay Lover returning, some old heads from Jersey All Pro that I haven't seen in like 20 years were there. That was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You guys have fun?
Oh, it was a phenomenal show, man.
Awesome. Awesome show. Awesome to see, again, the Jersey All Pro and Doghouse Mom and I. That locker room, awesome, chill guys. And thank you, Grim Reefer.
Shout out to Loud East, the entire locker room, your entire production, everything top to bottom. Yeah. You guys run a great show. I love your guys' logo, the Grand Theft Auto inspired Loud East flyer. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Kevin Gill, Raymond, and the OG Julius Smokes providing the commentary all night long.
Mm-hmm. Support what a them. Great commentary team. And Kevin Gill, man, what a great guy and what a professional. He was there too. I think he inducted. Was it Toby Klein? He inducted someone when I was there for, I think, Mondo. And he is a very intelligent man. I really like him, and I think he's a really good commentator.
So one of the things I wanted to talk to Billy about but didn't was Backyard Wrestling too, because he actually was in that game, and Kevin Gill was the one who was behind, you know, he was working for Eidos at the time. You know, Kevin Gill, actually, believe it or not, he's been involved with wrestling, like, behind the scenes for the better part of, like, over 20 years. And, you know, Backyard Wrestling 2 became, like, a landmark in a sense, because after that, he started working behind the scenes at JCW. So, you know, there was a lot of, there's a lot of, like, history that, you know, I personally would like to hear more about. So next time we get Messiah on, I want to hear about, you know, because I know there was a lot of promotional work. They did a whole Backyard Wrestling show with an actual ring where Messiah and Zandig actually worked. ICP did a match. So, you know, just anytime we get to have any of these guys on, I want to hear about it, because I'm a huge Backyard Wrestling too.
Yeah, we're going to have to get Messiah on like once a month or once like, to give, like, once we announce a few matches for the next event, I want to get his take on what he thinks and stuff, because he'll be watching the shows and he'll be able to give us feedback. But so that was last weekend. We had a great weekend. Loud East was awesome. I enjoyed Benny Candela. Benny Blanco was there. I got to see him. I got to see Fufu. Guys, that just blew my mind.
It was like a little mini reunion for you. I saw you, chopping up with a lot of, just your old friends and stuff. It was awesome to see that.
Well, and it shows you that what's going on in our little chunk of the business is actually happening everywhere. It's not just the old head CZW guys coming back. There's the old head Jersey All Pro guys coming back too, and the old head CZW guys. Yeah, it's like all of a sudden there's this rich history we embrace on the indies that I didn't even know existed 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And like, that's the stuff that you're gonna remember the most. It's like the matches, you know, the cherry on top. Like, the matches, obviously, you know, what we come there for. But, you know, again, I'm gonna remember seeing, you know, guys like Kevin Gill and, you know, just, you know, all those, you know, again, like, it's all the stuff outside of the match that you're gonna remember. The matches, like, you know,
it was very cool to be able to see like 2 to 3 different generations of tri-state wrestling come together. Right. You know, the guys from Johnny's era, like, you know, the Doghouse, Jersey All Pro, CZW, you know, era. And then guys like, you know, us who, you know, were trained, you know, you had guys like Evander James who were, you know, trained out of House of Glory. You had, you know, Jimi Hendrix, a protege of Mike Santana, you know, Chris Cage, a protege of the SAT, you know, these are Joey Janela, you know, these are all guys that grew up inspired by the Johnny Cashmeres, the Homicides, the Low Life Louis, the SATs, the Rick Blades, Low Keys, you know, the list goes on. And these guys are guys that are not slowing down. Yeah.
Joey was main event at Loud East Wrestling. So I mean, part of the reason that it drew so well was because of him and Homicide.
Him and Dom De Niro.
And Jimmy Lloyd had a sick match with table and ladder and stage and all kinds of sickness. So the whole show was just awesome. I loved it. I'm so excited to go back. It's going to be a lot of fun. You got something to say, Jay?
Yeah, no, again, just going back to what my brother said, like, being on these kinds of shows are so special, just to see, again, like, the generations, you know, of all different, between, again, guys from your era in between and then from our era, all in just one locker room. And it's like we all have that one common bond of just we're representing the tri-state, New York, New Jersey, so on. You know, it's
kind of like awesome. X-Men First Class a little bit. You know, it's like we got these generations now that are going to start coming together and it's going to weave together like a fabric. And it's going to make wrestling stronger because we're going to have more confident men like Messiah and Blade and, you know, the list goes on and on who can turn around to guys like you and instill confidence in you. So you guys can turn around to guys like Live Danger and instill confidence into them. It's all a trickle down thing. And if the guys up top aren't doing their job and pulling their weight, then the guys below don't really have much of a chance because there's nothing coming their way to work with.
Yeah. It's all about just taking pride in, again, we're all cut from the same cloth and we got to take pride in that. And when we're all in one locker room together, again, we should unite.
Yes.
And that's what it felt like.
Yes. So guys, I mean, this is it. We're at WrestleMania weekend already.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the reasons we started SPO Wrestling was because we knew WrestleMania was coming into town and we're like, why would we not take advantage? And then before you know it, it just became its own thing. And it was like, wait, we started this because Mania was in town. I don't even remember that. It seems like forever ago, but it's here. We named it End Game because this is our end game.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's insane. It's you know, you were even just last year, guys, like WrestleMania's in Philly. It's like, yeah, we're not really worried about that. And then it's like, now we're here, and wow.
Thank God we did our like due diligence. Yeah.
It's crazy. It really creeped up. But
if we would have sat on our asses back in September, October, November, we would not be in a position to have a WrestleMania event here on the weekend. And
not at
all. When all these big federations leave, we're going to still be here. SPO is still going to be here, and we're gonna have we're gonna have our chance to really get a crack at this area and let people see our brand of wrestling and how we like to do it. Because there really is something for everyone. You can have a family-oriented show and still make people laugh and enjoy it, and still have a guy like Corazon being pressed overhead from the ring outside through a door. I mean, that's not a death match because he's not bleeding, I guess, but I don't want to be pressed over someone's head and thrown outside through a door that's sitting between two chairs. So don't think, oh, it's family-friendly, we can't go, it's not going to be fun. No.
No, not at all.
It's going to be good. Uneffing believable was there. He enjoyed it. You know, some of the most.
It's something for everyone.
But some of the guys, the deathmatch guys out there, they have a very unique palette for wrestling. And even though we're not doing deathmatches right this minute, I still want the deathmatch fans because they're good fans. They really are. And they usually have open minds when you try stuff new. They're the first ones to get on board with new things. So,
yeah. They don't really. They're not one to really judge, you know.
No.
They just appreciate it. Yeah, exactly.
Right. So stay tuned, Deathmatch fans, because next week we'll probably have a big announcement that has to do with Deathmatch.
Hintity, hint.
You know, we started, you know, the SPOCAST leading up into, you know, the first, you know, show. And think about it. We started that leading up to the first show, and now we're ending the first season going into End Game. It's just how... perfect timing. Like this,
it's
the
like a, it's like a farmer. It's, we planted, the seeds and we watered it, and we got frustrated because nothing was popping up through the soil, and now stuff's popping up through the soil. It's a neat feeling. Yeah.
Has it really been like 20 consecutive weeks of doing these? At least one SPOCAST, and then plus possible, you know, additional SPOCAST Instagram, throughout the week.
You know, lives and stuff. Yeah,
it's it gave me a 1 month thing on my Facebook today of like a recap, and it said I made 300 and some posts in the last 30 days. Like,
that's
what?
Insane. That's insane. Jesus. That's insane.
Like, yeah, like I guess every time I post on Instagram, it automatically goes to Facebook. So it's all, but I don't know. But still, that's crazy. But guys, so it's finally WrestleMania. And the last thing we got to talk about is, where are the Backseat Boyz this WrestleMania? Well, there we go.
Oh.
So we got a nice collage that I made for us. Pretty nice. We got four pretty major bookings coming up. So what do we have, guys?
So this Thursday, we are defending the Super Crazy Pro Wrestling tag team titles in a cage match.
Primal Fear.
Yes. I don't know if that is the exact...
I don't know if that's the right collage or the right picture for the match graphic. But
I got the fully charged Friday night graphic. You're right.
Yeah. Well, we'll get that.
Confused. I was like, wait a second.
It doesn't matter because as long as you got the Backseat Boyz appearing, defending the Super Crazy Pro Wrestling Tag Team Championships, Steel Cage Warfare against Primal Fear this Thursday, live in Gloucester City, New Jersey.
That's Thursday, Gloucester City, New Jersey. Yep. So then Friday, we're in Philly we're at the ECW Arena right here in the middle, you see. Against Joel Gertner's team for Battleground. That's a pretty big event. Who else is on that event? Kendrick, we just talked about. Facade. It's going to be a really great event. So,
Balaba, Wrecking Ball Ligurski.
Brian Myers.
Swoggle.
Nice.
Who else do we have? I'm going to forget.
Doing the block party right after that, so which is neat.
It's stacked.
Well, the thing about the block party is so cool because if you go outside the building, you're underneath 95. So even if it were to rain, you're still like what better place to have a block party? That's where PW used to have our red carpet arrivals. That's where we used to have our crazy tailgate every year because it's just the perfect place. So what better? Go there, hang out with all these celebrities, and look at all the people on these posters. Like Rob Van Dam, the Dudleys, Atsushi Onita. Like what? Rhino, Tanaka, Masato Tanaka, Tatanka, Jake Roberts, like Matt Riddle. Like, look at all these people. One of the Eagles is going to be there. So this is going to be badass, man.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to that. I mean, you know, Loke, DeVito, the Carnage crew are going to be there. We're going to be at the block party meet and greet right after we destroy the Sex with Your Next Ex Express at Born to Die for BCW. Of course, you had mentioned Mr. Munn. It doesn't matter what kind of name it is.
Like,
you know, it
obviously. I know the new Backseats is like, what kind of name is that? You know, I'm joking, but it's like, you know. Like,
yeah.
We got this, guys. Like, this is going
to be. We got our, this.
You know, yeah. Well, Battleground, you know, we got this.
Come catch us at the meet and greet after.
Yeah.
Shout out to everyone.
I didn't add Saturday on here because that's a new booking we have, and we're not going to discuss that because it might be a surprise, but we're going to be booked somewhere Saturday as well. You'll see us.
Stay tuned.
Sunday is our event. There's the first, it's the induction ceremony for the Indy Hall of Fame in Philly at noon, which I'll be at with Donnie, Rick Blade. We'll all be there to do the induction. Shout out to our boy. And then from there, we come right back to Burlington for the 2:30 bell time for the outdoor steel cage matches. And then from there, put everyone back inside the building and the part two of the event starts. This is a unique event, something we've never tried before. And you know what, man? Sometimes when you step up to the plate and you point to the rafters and say, I'm going to hit a home run, and then you swing, sometimes you strike out. But you know what? Sometimes you hit a home run. So as far as I'm concerned, it's our duty to stand up and swing, whether we miss or whether we're going to swing for the fences. That's how I was told. If you're going to strike out, strike out swinging for the fences. Don't strike out being a wimp and acting like you don't want to swing. If you're going to swing, swing. And that's what we're doing. We're taking a swing. And if it doesn't work, we'll regroup and take another swing, because you better believe that we're going to get it right, because we're not going to give up till we do.
Mm-hmm. We're going to do it up. We're going to get it right. We're going to do it big. And best believe that we're going to start something big and spectacular. And this isn't going to be the first and only. This is going to be the first of its kind. This yearly series, it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, guys, any last things you want to say here before we actually take it home?
That's it. I think that's a wrap. I mean, wow. Season one, that's it. It's been real, and next week we start season two of the SPOCAST. Some major announcements coming up for our upcoming events. What is so for May and June? We're gonna announce some stuff for season two.
Big events, big stuff coming up. Stay tuned, guys.
And, stay tuned. You ain't seen nothing yet.
That's it, man. It's all coming full circle, brother. All the hard work starting to pay off, and the end game is upon us. All right, guys, time to take us home tonight. Peace out, guys.